What's up, Schmoedown fans? Welcome back to another episode of Beyond the Schmoedown. I'm Star Wars competitor, Andrew Dimalanta.
And I'm Nicki Dimalanta.
A little nervous right now. We have somebody with us that has been listening to the show.
Kind of important.
This is probably the biggest show we've had because he addressed us. He called us to be on the show. We didn't call him. It's the chairman himself, Kristian Harloff. Welcome to the show, Kristian.
Thank you. I know I had to extend my own invite. What is this nonsense?
We always thought like we were like
Christian's way too high profile.
No, not at all. Yeah. No, the show's been good. And you guys drove me nuts last week.
Yeah, I was fully expecting for you to come in and go,
"Shut up, stupid."
Hey, you got close. Although I like how Nicki kept defending herself. Like, I know I'm nitpicking, but yeah, you're nitpicking.
So obviously, we had a lot to say about the last match. I mean, I openly admit that we did take it a little too much, but like I look at these matches because obviously I'm in the tournament. These are some concerns that I have, but we understand that it's like it's the first time you're doing it.
Heck yeah.
We said it in the show. The tournament is the first of its kind. Right. It's on Twitch. There are certain things that have to be worked out on air, and you addressed this on SCN about what was happening. But I want you to give your thoughts on what you were, as you said, you were going crazy with us listening to the show. Like, what were the
first
issues
of all,
that you had?
Sorry.
No, first of all, don't apologize. That's the same thing I tell Frank. Never apologize. It's all if someone's listening and they were like, "Hey, wait a minute," then you're doing your job. Yeah. So you shouldn't apologize for it. It's exactly that. It's that it was the first match ever because it was the idea was what we needed to do with the. I wanted to run an Intergeekdom tournament to start. Before exhibition matches, and then it just came down. We had never tried it before. We were starting. The managers were like, "Well, what if this is going to happen? This is going to happen." And we said, like, "We could go back to shooting in the studio in 2 weeks. Then if we do that, then we're going to have this." And nobody wanted to do it, and it was too stressful. And I said, "Well, what if we just do exhibition matches instead? And let's try the format out and see if it works." So we started doing the exhibition matches, and they were working. And I go, "Maybe we can do the Intergeekdom." And we started putting the matches together, and then we were going towards Twitch because we want to do more on the Twitch platform. So when I was talking with Skybound, they said, "Do you have ideas for anything you wanted to do on Twitch?" And I said, "Yes, let's do a Star Wars tournament." I said, because if we do it, it allows us to showcase the Star Wars players because they haven't been normally and traditionally, as you know, Andrew, you maybe get – two matches, three matches if you're winning a year. Mm-hmm. It's tough, and it's just a limited division because we have to put the resources towards teams and singles. But because we did this, now we can really build out because it allows us to build the division out by doing a tournament. But we also had to really – I mean, we have a full team. Like, it's a production team that's Brian Mitchell and Courtney Luby amongst other people who are, you know, obviously our post team. And we had all these assets and everything we wanted to do, but there are certain things we just didn't know about, like what happens with the challenge. Okay, well, if a challenge, what's going to happen is I guess I'll talk to Mark. And when I tried to talk to Mark, he starts dancing. he doesn't know how to talk to me that way. Like, what are we supposed to do? PJ's highlighting things in the document. Mm-hmm. I know that it's Adi Monday, and I'm looking at it going, that's wrong.
Yeah.
But when I look into the document and I see it, and then I see a highlight, and I can't talk to my writer. I just see a highlight, so I'm thinking, all right, if he's highlighting it, then he's most likely telling me that somewhere in some kind of canon thing that I don't know about, that this is accurate, and they're standing by it. So I said, I really got to stick by the writers. And then I'm looking at it, I go, that's wrong. And I said to Ellis, I text him in the middle of the match, and I go, we got to reverse this decision. And he's like, I agree with you, but let's do it afterwards. Mm-hmm. So – And then I'm getting messages inside of the chat like, Winston already used this challenge. So I'm like, okay, Winston used this challenge already. I'm like, and then in my head I'm like, did he though? Because like you can't challenge. I'm like, you can't challenge the timing because I make that rule.
Yeah.
You don't get to challenge that because we're not going back and replaying it. So it was everything that was happening at one point that we knew that, and it wasn't the official tournament yet. It was a play-in match.
Yeah.
That's why we did a play-in match first. So when we did the tournament itself, we were like, okay, wait a minute. So now, if you watched it from this week, it was significantly better.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
And And it ran a lot smoother, and we did because we've also been pre-taping Inner Geekdom matches to make sure that we – and I'm going to give you all the results right now. No, I'm not. So we basically we look at it and we said, okay, this is what we need to do. And if there is a challenge now, what's going to happen is Mark and I will mute our microphones. We will call PJ, our head writer, and we'll do a speaker call that only the three of us will be privy to. Mm-hmm. We figured that would be a good thing. As far as challenges go, and as far as like managers are not allowed to look at the chat room in Twitch. Mm-hmm. They have to stay on the private chat. And that's how, so Andrew, for example, like next week when you want to talk to Dagnino, mm-hmm. you have to do it through private chat. You have to keep your private chat on the entire time. So, mm-hmm. it was everything that I don't necessarily disagree with what you were saying, but it's also concerns that it's like it doesn't need to be an overall big, huge concern because it's going to happen every week. It was addressed fast and furious, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, and I think my concerns had been more because of like there are like the only example that I have is my match for Laura Kelly was the Wedge Antilles question. The whole thing of where the lines, especially in Star Wars, the lines are so blurred between canon and the movie. Those are only my concerns, and it's only happened once so far. I doubt it'll happen again, but that's really what my concerns were. It's like the difference between a right and a wrong answer could be a phrase.
It cost you the match. Yeah. It cost you the match, and that's always. Like, look, again, to give PJ and the Raiders a lot of credit, PJ spent a whole weekend combing over both documents and fact-checking everything. Mm-hmm. Is he going to miss something? Of course he will. He's a human being.
Yeah.
Will it happen again? It might.
Possibly. It might, yeah.
It might. That's the unfortunate part of the game, but also the reason we love to hate parts of it, and it's like, it's part of it. There's going to be challenges again. There's going to be controversial callings again. It's just part of the, it's part of the game.
Yeah.
It's just a matter of how you deal with it. And that was a very particular circumstance where we were going to make the reversal call right then and there. Mm-hmm. But instead of doing, I mean, cause even when we, cause we're going to release it on YouTube now, and when we release it, it'll probably be edited. And I'll say it up top in the beginning, ladies and gentlemen, if you've paid attention, there's a reversal, but we're editing this in mm-hmm. as if it was an actual TKO.
Yeah.
So when you see it, it'll just play in like, you know, the question is asked, we say it's incorrect and it's TKO, and we'll edit it that particular way.
Yeah, and I can't remember who told me. I think it was you said that somebody in the Facebook group or somebody somewhere said that, like, oh, this has never happened. It's like, yes, this has happened before with Perry Nemiroff and her, I forget her partner was.
Oh, like a reversal.
Oh,
reversal.
Yeah.
You actually asked them a question, and I'm like, all right, well, so now we got to go back and film.
Yeah, that was a little bit of a different circumstance because the game was so young mm-hmm. back then, and I don't even know how that happened. It would never happen today, but like what happened was like somebody, like one of the teams wasn't asked their second round question.
I think it was something to do with the way the question was worded or something or.
I think we didn't give them a question. I think it was they were supposed to get five questions and they only got four. Something like that mm-hmm. in the second round. So it was whatever it was, and we noticed it and we said, "Oh, we got to give them another chance to get this." And then they got it and they tied it, and I remember thinking that's exactly what happened, cuz I remember thinking to myself, "Oh my god, if they come back and win this now, this is going to be a disaster." And I was like, and I've had that feeling mm-hmm. a few different times in this game. It's my most hated feeling when that stuff happens, because even PJ, when that happened with in the Star Wars match, mm-hmm. I texted him and said, "Are you kidding me, dude?" I said, "Are you kidding me with this?" I was like, after it all went down, I'm like, "What are we doing here?" On the first time, we've just went through this stupid ass Alba stuff, we're going through this.
Yeah,
I'm like, you know, it's just part of it. It's gonna happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh yeah, and it's also kind of a good opportunity for the competitors to be like. Flexing, be like, hey, actually, this. So, you know, it's kind of a fun, you know, be able to catch something like that.
Yeah. So, you can see the significant difference between the play-in and this match, because it's like the rules felt different. It felt like it flowed differently. Like, all right, you get 60 seconds to confer with your manager, and it's everything went off the hitch. Obviously, no challenges went down. But yeah, so far the Twitch, like I said when we were had the exhibition's coming out, I was like, they can totally do something like this over stream. It's easily. Yeah. It's just the only thing that you brought up was like team matches can't happen over.
I don't know how you would engineer team matches.
And that was a question.
We're not doing team matches.
Yeah, no.
And that's another thing I wanted to sort of ask you about, is like the speed round. Like the speed round for the exhibition match, it was a little wonky, just because, you know,
saying your name, but yeah, it's an exhibition match. We're not going to be doing, the only thing that we look here's the plan, or at least crossing the fingers plan, is that we would like to be somewhere that we can shoot the finals, that we're able to shoot the finals somewhere. But realistically, with everyone like yourself and Molly that's in the tournament, like if one of you guys make it to the finals, we have to do it virtually right now.
Because
the crew, I mean, I can tell you that the crew and a lot of people, nobody's comfortable with either flying or being around people who are flying right now. It's like, it's not to play the game. So we have to come up with something, whether it is a matter of first person to type their name inside of the chat, private chat, which is something.
Their name or the answer? I think I'm misheard.
Not the answer. No.
Because that was scary.
That was something that I was like, I don't think that works, because then like minutes per whatever it's called.
No.
And I know myself, if somebody's watching me type, I forget how to type.
It would basically be, you have to put your initials in, and the first person to put their initials in would be able to answer.
The buzzer. I like that.
It's like a buzzer. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because we did it again. I think it was during the Rocky match for me and Roka, and we did the speed round, and it worked pretty well. Mm-hmm. But the problem is that when you have people that, if you're competing and it's just clear cut, it's like Andrew, and then okay, Andrew goes, as opposed to when you say it at the same time, then you've got to have your ear to it, and then it's really on the judges, because those buzzers, they light up green. They know who goes first.
I mean, so if I might suggest, I'm not trying to tell you how to run things, but maybe have the competitors pre-type like their name or something, and all I have to do is hit enter to send it, because then it would be sort of the same thing as hitting a button rather than.
Well, that's already part of it.
Okay,
that's already part of it.
So they pre-type their name, and then
like for each question, make sure that you already have. It's essentially the speed run is return. The button is the return button.
That's a great substitute.
That's
part of the plan. It's just your initials. It's not a light.
That's why you're here.
but one of the things, though, that, you know, then what you'd have to do, and what we will do, because the same way that we're asking competitors to show their hands, right, the same thing that we're going to have to do is we're going to show screenshots and send them to the competitors afterwards to show them, like, who got it in first.
Mm-hmm.
Because last thing we want, and I think that's fair for competitors to ask that, because again, it's never happened realistically, but it's happened as far as accusations of like, oh, Harloff wanted this person to win because that's a more attractive match than this. So let's, and especially if you're a competitor, right? If you're a competitor and you're competing like, oh, he wanted that person to win, so I didn't get, I clearly clicked return first. Like, well, you didn't. And how would you know that you did anyway? So here's to prove that you didn't.
Yeah.
And then we do the screenshot, and then we'll send that to everybody at the end of the match.
Yeah.
Make it more transparent.
That's the tricky part about the virtual things, is because people are always going to try to find something like, oh, well, obviously this is, because they're going to find something to complain about, even if these weren't virtual.
Yeah.
Everybody's always complaining about something in the Schmoedown. That's like, and one of the most notorious things is difficulties of questions and things like that. But like,
there's always something.
It's always something.
That's my most hated one, is when someone goes, that was a 5-pointer. It's like, to you it was. It wasn't a 5-pointer.
It's
to
subjective.
You
it was.
Yeah, it's all
like
subjective.
I always bring up the Better Off Dead one, when it was Bibiani versus, it was like the triple threat, I think. And Bibiani got something about the Better Off Dead, or where it was, the ski thing. He's a kid of the 80s. You know, he knew it. We asked all these people that were probably in the 25 to 28, or I think Chance Ellison and Oyama were there. They had no idea what it was. And it's like you have to, it's all subjective. It's easy to you, and that's why this is, you might have a strength in that category. So it drives me nuts when fans and competitors say, that was an easy 5-pointer.
Yeah.
To you, not to the casual fan. Like,
it's
so
true. Like, we'll get to that with this match.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, exactly. Anything?
I was shocked that I knew a 5-pointer.
Yeah, was there anything else that you wanted to sort of bring up to about these past couple of matches, the exhibitions, the Star Wars matches that we've gotten so far, that you were just like, wanted to get off your chest?
No, we just ran the Lord of the Rings one today.
Oh, yeah.
Have you had a chance to watch that one?
We watched it when it first came out.
Yeah.
It was so good. It was just such a slugfest all the way through. Mm-hmm. And I just rewatched it, the ending of it anyway. And it's really good. And we put it out there. It's live, because now, you know, obviously Monday, the play-in match between Goddard and Vaveta airs to patrons.
Nice.
So that's for the Inner Geekdom tournament starts next week. So we'll have at the same time Star Wars and Inner Geekdom playing at the same time. Yeah. So it'll be pretty nuts.
Yeah, I hadn't had this feeling of like anticipation for matches and tournaments.
It's so exciting.
It's so exciting. I hadn't been this excited for this round since the draft. Like the draft was such like a shot in the arm. Like, oh man, I can't wait for the season.
Oh,
and then Corona hits. It's like, Jesus, what are we gonna do now? And then announcement of the tournaments comes. I'm like, oh okay, this is. We're back at it. So it was, I'm excited for this tournament. I'm excited to see the players go through the IG tournament. And obviously, I'm excited to compete. So
I guess.
Yeah.
I guess I'm
sure. Yeah, I'm sure you are. I mean, like, that's the thing. Like, we and I say it, and I'm sure you know, I'm sure you're sick of hearing it, that you're, you know, for you, this is a tough match. We know that. And you got, listen, man, had the chips just gone your other way, you could have easily had, and nothing against Adam Witt, but you could have had Adam Witt in the first round. You could have had Sean Sullivan in the first round. Mm-hmm. I think your knowledge is that good. You just, like, look at Chance Ellison. Chance Ellison is something like, I don't know, 1-2 or 2-3 or something in singles.
I think he's 1-3 or 1-2. I think he only has one.
He's won twice, I think, in singles. I don't know. Either way, the point is he's a lot better. He's a lot better than what his record indicates. Mm. But he keeps getting stuck in these matches because that's where the record puts you. Yeah. And so when I was going through this, I'm like, yeah, I mean, look, it's one of those things where you could be, if you're a fighter and you're like, this guy is so good at jiu-jitsu and he's karate and he's so good. Yeah. But in UFC, he's 2-4. It's like, okay, well, he's really good. Yeah, but he's 2-4. He might be, and he might be able to fight his way back up into the contendership, but that's where he is at the moment.
Yeah.
And again, that's the unfortunate part of being in the Star Wars division.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. I mean, we have this conversation all the time off air. It's like, it seems like everybody seems to forget that somebody else was 0-2 in this division not too long ago.
Oh, yes.
And it's the guy I'm going up against.
Yeah.
My story and Scrimshaw stories are almost identical.
They're pretty parallel.
They're almost identical.
Right. Both debuted in a 5-way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Both lost to people that either have had the belt or contended for
the belt. Were very high contenders for the belt.
And his losses aren't knockout losses. They're not like he got blown out. He lost
by one
point, 2 points. All when it came down to last points, last questions.
Yeah.
So, you're not wrong. You're not wrong, dude, because the thing is with him, and it's funny because this is how – one win in the Star Wars division goes a very long way because people are saying that, you know, because Scrimshaw is probably the favorite to win the tournament right now, right? Yeah. He's only won one Star Wars match.
It's
crazy. He's only won one match.
Yeah.
That's it. And inside, Ken is a former Star Wars champion. He's only won one Star Wars match.
The one to get the belt?
Yep, yeah, that's it. The one that we couldn't get into was Orlando.
The one that we were sitting outside like, man, I wish we could be watching the Schmoedown.
It was crazy.
It was crazy because we got turned away, and then meanwhile, I met up with Hartwell.
Yeah.
First time I ever met Hartwell in person. And he's like, he posted a picture on Twitter. He's like, hey, it's time to Schmoedown. I'm like, how did you get in?
I think I let him in through the back
door. Yeah, that was the thing. He's like, I know people. I'm like, of course you know people.
So. Yeah,
but here we are. So,
what's so funny about that one is I remember when we were booking that out and they said, hey, we're going to give you a room. It's like 800. I said, can we have something a little bigger? And they said, and they were like, no, this is going to be the room that they get. We go, okay, well, that's cool. And I said, well, maybe we'll fill it out. We'll probably fill it out in a couple hours. We filled it out like immediately. And I was like, holy crap. And it was like, we turned away apparently like 800 people, which was crazy.
That was one of us.
Yeah.
I remember we showed up like 30 minutes before, like, oh, we'll get in. And the line wrapped around the building and they had like a person at the end, like, all right, no more people.
We clearly didn't know how celebration works.
That was our first celebration, so.
I would have thought, I didn't know. I would have been, it would have been on me because I would have told you, yeah, you'd be fine. I had no idea. It was just because there was so much excitement at that particular celebration. And then, you know, obviously the addition of everybody that was on that panel, plus the fact Sam Witwer was going to be on it. It was pretty nuts.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So speaking of celebration, it doesn't look good.
I'm in denial.
So far, but say celebration does happen. Does the fact that we're having a Star Wars tournament negate that fatal 5-way?
Or any kind of match?
Probably.
Yeah, I can't imagine the crew or anybody being comfortable enough to want to compete. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're talking about August.
Yeah,
yeah, you know, it's 2 months away.
Well, say it gets the pushback. It's like it's not being canceled. Maybe it gets pushed back to December,
January, or something.
They can't do that though.
Yeah.
I know people who run those things. It takes so long to plan out and move them, and it. I mean, I guess, you know, if they're really working on it, then maybe it's a possibility. But I don't know. I wouldn't be surprised if they do the same thing that like Comic-Con's doing and do virtual.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like do their big, you know, because Star Wars lends itself to kind of be able to do that and it kind of tune in. Because I remember watching the London one when I decided I didn't go to that, and I was watching that virtual, and it's pretty good. But yeah, it's nothing like being there for a live thing. But they're probably push it and do it next year. It's just I'm sure there was a ton of announcements that they were going to do
Obi-Wan stuff, probably a movie announcement or directors for at least movies.
Like what else are these shows they're talking about? Is it official? I mean, if we're August, is it official that Ahsoka's coming back? Are there going to be spinoff shows? Like what? There's a lot of stuff that kind of broke that they could have done and they might still do, but I don't know.
I'm still in denial.
Yeah. I mean, the one good thing, like, if there's a bright side, for us at least, for the Star Wars tournament, is now we don't have to fly to California.
I guess.
we get to save money.
If that's the bright side.
But yeah, I'd much rather be in studio, because there's no experience like that live event. It's because, like, I talked to Dagnino about this before. He's like, I was looking forward to coaching you. I was looking forward to having, you know, the exchange with me and behind me, but, like,
well, I'll give you some good news if you want that. Like if you know, we're still trying to get Spectacular to happen live in December. Mm-hmm. We're crossing our fingers that at that point that we're able to do it, and we're hopefully do it at the Globe. That's the goal. But and if people are flying by then, the winner of the Star Wars tournament will most likely get flown out to compete for the championship.
That'd be cool.
That'd be cool.
Yeah.
That'd be pretty cool.
Mark your calendar.
Crossing fingers if things go well.
Yeah, I mean, that's great.
Because I did see somebody in the Twitch chat, I think, if I'm not mistaken, I swear I saw somebody in the last match be like, yo, is this what it's like to be at a live show? I'm like, no.
That's a fraction of the feeling, it's
maybe like a 16th of the feeling. Right. Like, you need to go to one if you haven't been to one.
Yeah, there's nothing like a Schmoedown Live
event. No. It is like watching a live event.
Yes.
On Twitch, on the same way that I've watched back the replay and stuff and I've watched a throwdown when I wasn't able to be at the Bibiani chance match. Mm-hmm. I watched it, and there's like this excitement when you're watching like anything, any live sport. You feel that. Mm-hmm. So I'm excited that that's back, and kind of coupling off what Andrew said before. With you know, that excitement, because even though we had these matches that were pre-taped, everybody knew that they were pre-taped, and you knew they were, and you only got once a week, and they weren't any high-profile matches yet. They were really like building new competitors and watching, and it wasn't, and the storylines weren't building up, so it was like, okay, yeah, I'm curious to watch a couple of these matches, but it wasn't that this is happening now feeling, and that's what we get with Star Wars and IG.
Oh yeah. Do you want to check the Facebook group really quick? So if you have any questions before we move on to the...
Yes, I did actually a little bit ago. Let me let it load. Okay.
Sure.
So we do have a couple things. The first one says...
Oh, God.
How scared is he of facing Scrimshaw?
Okay, so if you... If you want my honest opinion about that, because I don't want to talk too much about my match, because everybody knows what I'm going to say.
Yeah.
To be honest,
it's the week before. You got to talk about it.
Okay, so
do what you got to do, baby boy.
To be honest, there's nobody in this tournament that I'm scared of. Then that's the god honest truth.
That's good.
Because I said it before on this show. I've said it before on multiple other podcasts I've been on. After my loss to Laura Kelly, I gave it 3 weeks off and got right back into studying. There's been a small lull with Corona, but I haven't stopped studying. I haven't stopped watching the movies. We're back to I'm not going to give away all of it, but I've watched like every single Star Wars movie at least 3 times this week.
This week.
to be honest, like I've said it before, like whoever gets put in front of me, I really don't care. It's like you can ask me like, who do you prefer if you beat Scrimshaw? Who do you want to see over, you know, Wit or Molly? Doesn't matter. I don't care. But yeah,
you gotta want Kelly though again.
There is something that like I would like to have see Laura Kelly, but I do want to see Ken. Like if the opportunity presented to go against Ken, it's like who wouldn't want to go against Ken?
Right.
But there is a part of me that's like, yeah, I want, and I can almost say definitively that it's gonna be me and Laura again in the final. That's pretty much what I see. And she had some things to say on the Twitch stream. That I'm just gonna,
you know,
put back here.
Yeah, it is.
I'm just gonna put back there. But
she looked good though. She looked good.
She did. So since we're on, let's go ahead. We'll move on to
William Bibbiani chimes in, and he said in all caps, "Why the thingy?"
I want a shirt. Can I get a shirt real quick that says William Bibbiani chimes in? Everywhere I go, I should look in the mirror and say, no matter what it is, it's like I order a bagel at a store. Bibbiani chimes in. Everywhere you go, Bibbiani chimes in.
He really does. Yeah, and that's what everywhere. We all say.
That's it.
Well, William Bibbiani chimed in, in all caps, why the thingy is the thingy now? I don't know.
Exactly.
And then he comments, why, with like 7 whys. So
thanks, Bibbs.
Bibbiani's having a lit Friday night.
He was our third.
If I was to guess, I would guess there's probably a misspelling in my post, and he has to comment on it or something. If I was going to guess,
no, I don't see any. You're good.
No, right, well, that seems like a Bibbiani thing to do, but I don't know.
Thanks, so Bibbs. Somebody asked, how well would Nicki do an IG? Not well, Brian.
I think that's a comment on we just posted one of our Schmoedown play alongs.
I don't know if you're aware, Christian, but we do like play alongs to past matches with me because I haven't seen like any movies. And the most recent one was an IG. It was the 5-way with like Keaton Markey and Adam Halavik.
You got 8 points.
I was there.
fair enough.
Somebody, this is not related to this podcast, but someone asked when you'll watch The Thing.
Well, I'm supposed to watch it now because we got to 4K. I contemplated watching it last night or tonight because I'm going to do a watch along with everybody, but I'll do that after I watch it. I am going to watch it, but I'm going to finish The Last Dance first.
I have not picked it up yet because it's not Star Wars, so I'm not watching it right now.
We got other obligations.
Yeah,
I don't blame you.
Yeah.
It's all.
Yeah, last thing you need is a question, and you go, Dennis Rodman. Wait, he's not in.
Anytime he talks about something else, I'm like, don't stress your brain with anything other than
Star
Wars.
She did that to me because I wanted to catch up on the Mandalorian documentary thing, and she's like, that doesn't sound like a movie.
Excuse me, that's not canon.
Sorry.
It's like Mickey. It's like Mickey. Yeah, I love it.
When will the team's tournament be virtual or in the studio?
It has to be in the studio.
If we do it, it'll probably be in like October, November in the studio. That's the goal.
Makes
if it
sense.
Happens.
IG question. Will the winner of the IG tournament play the winner of Smets and Chandru, or will it be a triple threat?
No, play the winner. They'll play the winner.
Yeah, I don't see it being a triple threat. I
don't want to waste that.
That. And that wouldn't be fair to Chandru at all, I don't think, because Chandru's earned his shot.
He almost lost his shot, though, with his big mouth.
William Bibbiani chimes in again.
Thanks, Bibbs.
Okay, but serious question. When the game returns to the studio, whenever that is, what sort of changes are we likely to see, either to the staging or the format? Or will it be back to normal in every way?
It won't be back to normal in every way. No. I mean, to peek behind the curtain, I had a conversation with the production team before I was on this show, and we were going over. So we're looking at a theater right now. We're no longer going to be shooting at Collider.
Oh, nice.
That's over. We're looking at renting a theater and shooting matches. So we have to find the California guidelines, make sure everything is that we're up to code with that. We have to make sure that everything on our team and people who are working from Skybound we got to talk to HR over at Skybound and make sure that everything is kosher over there. We have to look at the actual studio, the theater itself, and figure out if we are doing teams matches. Like when you confer with somebody, you're not going to be able to do it the way that you normally do it, sitting next to each other. You're going to have to be, you know, the teams will most likely be like a live event. Most likely will be standing, you know, and will be, and during like rounds, we'll put them close enough apart where they'll turn the microphones off, be able to talk, and maybe even get noise reduction headphones if we have to. You know, so there's things that we're going to be working on. But the first thing is to get through these IG tournaments, and then we're aiming for July to return to the studio. That's the idea. It's not confirmed by any means, but it's what we're looking at.
Yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah. Anything else?
Drew Grant chimes in and says, when is video, Drew? Don't know the answer to that.
Don't know the answer to that.
I think these competitors, some of them are just kind of sitting and then they just start talking, but they don't realize that they're actually typing and they're like talking into a mirror to themselves and they just type out and then it just word vomits onto them. So you just got a small peek into my life of what I deal with.
I
and that's just two of the competitors.
Okay? I can't even imagine.
So now imagine the entire, do you understand the whole reason I came up with this freaking draft is so I didn't have to deal with the competitors. So now only the managers are who I deal with because I made it. So I even said a couple people texted me afterwards. I said, you don't have to text me anymore. Have your manager.
Talk to your managers,
it.
Yeah.
If I have to hear one more suggestion about this or that or what or entrance music or I don't like my nickname, like I do this, like talk to your manager, please.
Well, while we're at it, Kristian, I would like to change my nickname. No, I'm just
kidding. Yeah.
Yeah. Rookies don't get to do that. Well, I'm not a rookie anymore, but rookies don't get to do
you
that.
You got to earn it. You got to earn it.
When studio tapings resume, will there be an audience, and what changes will occur? We kind of just did.
We kind of, yeah.
No,
let's take a couple more.
No, well, I didn't address the one thing is that yeah, what we will do is the difference is if you've been to a studio taping, the difference that from significant difference is you could hang out and watch the matches all day. If you had a match for this type of taping, it's you shot your match, you're done. See you later. You're out. You know, it's like thank you. You go out the door, then we bring the next people in. We're not doing a big. A big thing, but there is something to be said that once we are allowed to have more people in, that I think there's something fun about renting a theater and packing it out with everyone in it to have like a mini live event, like, but it's like a studio match.
Exciting. You know, that'd be exciting. Yeah. Let's take a few more because I want to get into this match because we're running out.
Well, luckily there only are a few more.
Thank you.
What matches do you hope to get to happen once studio tapings resume?
I mean, the Roca Irwin match, obviously, right?
Well, Roca Irwin would be a throwdown. Smets and Chandru would be a throwdown.
Oh, yeah.
Corruption versus Founding Fathers would be a throwdown. Guy versus Kalinowski would be a throwdown. Mm-hmm. So those are probably four throwdowns that I would do like immediately when we're allowed to do them.
Yeah, you're
can't wait.
Yeah, doubling down on live events or live streams.
Yeah.
And especially since that poll was up of who everyone's excited to see come back, it's like it's perfect. It's like everyone votes for who they want to see. So it's like, all right, there are the matches. Do you think there will be any live events anywhere the rest of the year?
If there is, I would say Spectacular is probably the only one that I can see happening, and it would probably be in Los Angeles. I don't see us traveling anytime soon.
Yeah, that's only reasonable.
Yeah.
And then the last one is how often do you plan... Oh, Star Wars related.
Oh.
How often do you plan to reset the template for the Star Wars division in terms of questions? The questions will start to run out after so many matches. Let me take this one. There are so many questions to ask in Star Wars, and you don't even know.
Well, that goes back to Andrew's comment last week where... when you have regular matches, when they're not tournament matches, then there's only six questions in the first round. Title matches and tournament matches, it's 10 questions.
Yes. Yeah. That makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah. But, to your point.
I mean, we are recycling questions that was established a while ago. Yeah. And also, there's so much stuff to ask in Star Wars. If you don't think there is, you're not paying attention.
She doesn't agree with me, but if you ever need like a fifth for like a celebration match. She's
if you need someone to cruise in at fifth place.
Well, you might retain a lot more than you think with this lunatic. Yeah.
I am a bit of a nerd.
Yeah.
So call me if you need me, okay?
We're always looking for new people, especially it's one of those, and I'm always looking for especially female competitors, absolutely, but just sassy competitors for sure. We're always looking for personalities and Star Wars even Andrew, when you auditioned, I told you that, you know, it's like, if you're good, if you can hold your own in Star Wars, you got a good shot to make it, but you also got to be able to, you got to be good on the mic. You got to be able to talk, and because that's how you sustain inside of the Schmoedown. Like you can be really good, but you can't sustain with the audience. Like I did that poll in the Facebook group of like the top personalities and people that people would want to pay to see.
Yes.
Right. And I will just say that a lot of the like really great trivia players, you don't see them in the top like five.
It's the Andrew Guys.
Andrew Guy was number two.
And he's also a good trivia competitor. He's no one to be underestimated.
He's good. He's good. But he's not like these, like, you know, like there are some people who just answer questions and that's all they do.
Yeah.
Like that are just like these movie minds.
Yeah.
Like without Bibiani, to his credit, has been able to do both of those things.
Mm-hmm. He has.
And so he was, and I think he was in the top 10, you know? So that's why, like, you've got to be, as long as if you're good on the mic, you understand it. It's easier now to find people, competitors, coming into this thing that understand it, yes. As opposed to when we first started with pundits being involved in it and going, wait, what are we doing? Wait, mm-hmm. why am I like him. Why am I yelling at them? You know, it's like that is gone now because people know what it is. Mm-hmm. And now it's, you find these people. I mean, look at Paul Oyama, Robert Parker, mm-hmm. Chance. They all came from the fan leagues and they all were watching this and understanding with all these new people coming in. They get it now. And it's not, I don't deal with it as much as I used to of the competitors who don't understand what we're doing anymore.
Yeah. Luckily.
Luckily, yeah.
That's the draw of evolving, I guess.
Yeah. So, since we're running out of time, let's go ahead and get into this match that we got against Laura Kelly and Sean Sullivan.
Yes.
Bring up your notes.
So Laura, lights out Kelly.
Changed her name.
Sean, she changed her name. She was Luminess, mm-hmm. but now she's the lights out. So she's against Sean the Saint. I'd like to know how that name came about.
That was Ellis's doing, I believe.
Ellis?
Yeah, it was. I think so. We were trying to figure that out at one point because Sean told me it was. And like I remember it being this crazy day at the mm-hmm. studio. And I was like, did I come up with that? I don't remember. And then like I think Ellis, because I really like it. I really like it a lot. So yeah.
I was wondering.
I'll give it Ellis.
Good job, Mark. Yeah. So let's just dive right into it. So round one, they both did very well.
Mm-hmm.
Sean misses one question. And right. I don't rats remember the topic of the question. You can fill in those blanks. Mm-hmm. Rats and burger. Mm-hmm. He puts rats and burg. Let me just point something out that I feel like I observed. I don't know if it's true or not, but when he was writing it, it looked like he kind of erased a little something.
Yeah.
And I can only wonder, and I'll never know. Did he erase the ER?
Yeah.
I don't know.
And he kind of smiled after the answer.
Yeah, so maybe he's like, God, I shouldn't have done that. And
so I wonder. But most competitors probably would have been like, oh, no, I had that.
Yeah.
So it just leaves me to, I'll never know, and I mm-hmm. won't be able to sleep tonight. So there's that. So he missed Ratzenberger. Laura gets it, and that's the only one he missed.
Yes,
to his
that's
credit.
The only one.
Laura gets a perfect round because that's just what she do, baby. And then she gets the bonus question. With, you know, Yoda and R2 fighting over the space torch.
The space torch, as Steel Saunders would say.
So at the end of round one, it's 9-11 in favor of Laura.
Mm-hmm.
Round two, Laura opts to go first. She gets Return of the Jedi. She only goes multiple choice once. And it was a question about Luke keeping a promise to a friend.
Promise to a friend, yeah.
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 She gets it, though. No steal. Really not much to talk about because there was no steal.
Yeah.
Sean gets the Phantom Menace. He also goes to multiple choice once. When Jar Jar was on Tatooine, he like shoots his tongue out, eats a thing. What does the vendor want to charge him for his snack?
This was a ridiculous question.
This was a funny question for me personally. So he got it. It was 7 whoopee.
Yeah, but it took him a repeat and
a multiple choice.
Yeah.
And a repeat of the multiple choices, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
Which didn't cost him a JTE.
No, you can do it. You can repeat the multiple choice once throughout the match.
Without charging.
Without getting charged, yes.
Wow, so only once. So one repeat of the options throughout the match, right? I think that's what I do.
Never mind.
Don't mind me. Ignore me. I'm speaking out loud right now.
Just taking notes.
Yeah.
By the end of round two, 18-20 in favor of Miss mm-hmm. Laura Lights Out. Round three, Sean goes first. He gets a 2-pointer in movie quotes. Who said about Palpatine, about killing Palpatine? Who said that I sure would like to?
Mm-hmm.
Anakin. He gets it.
Took him a little longer than... Did he use another repeat on that?
I feel like he did.
Maybe.
Yeah,
because
it took him a while to get to there.
I feel like he did. He might have burned his last one. Laura gets her 2-pointer in the Clone Wars, the nickname that Ahsoka gave to Anakin. Sky Guy. Mm-hmm. She got it. Bounces back to Sean.
I don't want to watch that movie, but I've seen it like 12 times.
I've seen Clone Wars more times than I care to admit.
Right. Yeah. It's better. It's still a horrendous movie, but like the thing is like when you watch it, I think it's because of the addition of Clone Wars, the TV show that it just feels like a throwaway episode of the Clone Wars, and you're like, okay, well, this all adds into everything else that happens inside of the show. Yeah. So I deal with it a lot better now.
Doesn't that movie, yeah, like, it, within the actual order of the viewings, isn't it coming until, like, end of season one, closer to season two? That's, like, so weird.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, so you're going to, whatever.
Let's be honest.
We can talk Star Wars all day, but, like,
I'd rather watch Clone Wars than Attack of the Clones, if we're going to be honest here.
Oh, wow.
That's, yeah.
Yeah.
Christian agrees.
Yeah, the TV show? I would much rather watch
the movie.
I haven't watched the TV show, but I'd watch the movie.
I'll tell you what. I revisited the movie. When I saw the movie, I went to the premiere, and I remember that. When I went to the premiere of that movie, and I saw Dave Filoni for the first time, now you know how I feel about Dave Filoni now, but when I was walking out of that theater, and I was with my buddy, and I look at him, I go, that's the guy who ruined Star Wars. Right? So I look, and in my head, right? And then it's fast forward to today when I think the guy can walk on water. I rewatched that movie recently. I think it's the same thing in what I just said with, you know, the TV show. It just feels like a long episode. It's like kiddish, and I feel like I was watching it with my daughter. She loved it, and I didn't hate it as much as I did beforehand.
You can almost see it if you watch the movie. It's like, oh, once they finish the Battle of Christophsis, that's where the episode ends. That's where it should end, and then you pick it up with the stuff on Tatooine.
Yeah.
So
it's not good. But I'd rather watch it before the Attack of the Clones.
It took her 3 days to finish Attack of the Clones the first time.
Oh, boy. I kept falling asleep. It's rough. All
right.
So she gets that Clone Wars question. She got it. Sky Guy. 3 points back to Sean. He gets a question that had a little bit of, I don't even know if I want to use the word controversy, but it was in the realm of villains.
Death Star?
Yes. The Death Star. How many crawls mentioned the Death Star? And it was 3.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like the challenge is irrelevant.
I think so too.
I think it's the idea. If I was going to talk to the writers themselves, if the idea is probably because the way that they're thinking is that heroes and villains, that the where do the villains reside? Where do the villains reside?
That's
like as far as like where what part? Like when you think of the Death Star, like whose base is the Death Star? It's the villains.
Yeah, it's a
like
bad guy thing.
That's a good way to.
That's what they're. Yeah, so that's what they're looking at as far as villains go. It's like it's their home base. It's like when you think of like and an argument can be made for vehicles and technology and stuff too that they could fit there. But the same thing, you know, could be. So if I wouldn't if it was Inner Geekdom and it was a heroes like about Batman's car. It was about the Batmobile and the Batmobile has this, and this.
True.
And it's Batman's car, so it's a hero's car.
Yeah.
So. I don't think that they would have won that challenge if they would have challenged it. So, that one didn't really bother me.
And no stink on Sean, but like it's like no matter what it was categorized, it wasn't in his head. So either you know it or you don't know it.
Even if it was weapons vehicles, it still wasn't there at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe at another time it was. Because I know people in the chat, I don't know how much you pay attention to chat, Christian, probably
not during the match.
Because I know people were like, what? The Death Star is not sentient. And I'm like, wow.
Well, it is sort of treated like a character in Rogue One, if I can speak like, you know, just on that. It's like, it is kind of treated like a character in Rogue One. Like you see it and it's like this looming thing. So
it's a bad guy thing.
Yeah.
It is. It's the bad guy's base. And it's the villain's base. It's the villain's.
Yeah. A hero's question being something about a lightsaber. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
It's a villain's thing. So stands.
Exactly. It stands.
And
5-pointer obviously stays with Sean, the Phantom Menace. What system is Ben Quadraneros from?
Is it planet or you know, system?
I don't remember I the exact said, wording.
I think it said planet. Yeah.
Planet.
Yeah.
You know this one, Dimalanta? Did you know it?
Of course I knew it.
Yeah, you should say that even if you didn't.
No,
I knew it too.
Not to flex, but the past two, the play-in and this one, since my match with Laura Kelly, I've missed. Yeah. I played along with all of them. I missed one question, and it was only because I didn't go to multiple choice.
Oh, don't show your cards.
But but the last two matches, I've gone perfect. No multiple choice. I've known everything. So
awesome.
I knew the ton system, so I'm pretty proud of myself.
Yeah. Well, if you knew that, you should be competing. I'll tell you that, because that was a tough one.
I mean,
she.
I knew it. That's all.
How did you do? How did you do in that match?
I didn't tally up how many I actually missed. I mean, I don't think I would not have won.
I remember looking at you when the questions were out, because like I was in my head, and you're like, oh yeah, it's.
I at least tied with Sean. At least. I don't know how many points I actually got.
We are actually going to do another play along. The next play along we're doing after all this is after my next match or after the tournament. We're doing the the Knapsack Whitwer match.
Oh,
with you.
Oh, wow.
So that's what she's gonna be playing.
Okay,
around. So
the Iron Man. Match.
Yeah. So
that's a good.
Yeah,
match.
The Iron Man.
Check it out, baby. It's gonna be good.
Have you seen that match before, Nicki? Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Oh, I've definitely seen the match before. Definitely. Oh, okay. I mean, I've seen all the Star Wars matches. So
such a good match.
Oh, yeah.
It was a good match. Yeah. I can't wait. That's going to be good. I didn't know that was our next one, so that was fun for me.
We said it was our next one, but anyways.
I'm ready. So the match ended up, he missed it, you know,
mm-hmm.
and right. I respect his honesty in saying that he never even heard of the TUN system.
I mean, it's a very background-ish quote in the movie.
It was a throwaway quote,
if you're
really.
Not paying attention to the movie, you're like, oh, no character saying any words, you'd be like, okay, whatever.
Right.
And
who cares about Boon to Eve? You know what I'm saying? So the match ended up 20-22 in favor of Laura.
Yeah.
So that's what we got going.
Yeah. So what were your thoughts on Sean's performance? Because he didn't have the best of Star Wars competitors' performances in his first match. And again, it's circumstances because he's called in last minute and things like that. But what did you guys think of his performance this time around? Because
I think for a rookie, he's doing pretty damn good. I mean, he won his first match in a very short notice because what had happened was that Andrew Guy was supposed to compete with the family match, and he got ill that day. And I reached out to Kate. I said, look, can we get Sean and to do a match? And to Adam's credit, he also went on short notice, and they both played. And, you know, it was a fun match, and he's got a good personality. He's a really good guy. He's never complains. Well, he's still a rookie, so give it time. But, and then, you know, he gets in there, and I thought he scrapped with one of the best in the division.
Yeah, I would argue he had the toughest first round because I know firsthand how good Laura is, and you know,
no one to be messed with. And the polls.
No, and her new attitude. Her new attitude is scary. Like I love this confidence in her. Like because the other times I've spoken with her and at the. She's super nice, but she was a little timid, you know, and like this is the first time I saw her just embrace like, no, I'm good at this. Like, I'm really good at this and I'm going to show you I'm good at this. And I think Shannon adds to that.
Oh yeah.
And it was so, I mean, that promo was so awesome when she has the red saber at the end, and like I loved it. I thought, I mean, Laura Kelly to me is like one of the superstars of the division right now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No, she definitely she definitely seems very comfortable with corruption. I think it was an excellent choice.
Yes.
Yeah.
I can't imagine her in any other faction at this point.
What were your thoughts on Sean though? Like
Christian said, I feel like for a rookie, and I don't mean for it to sound condescending like that, like for a rookie, you know.
Hey, we've seen.
I think
Laura
he did
was a rookie last year. See, look what happened.
Yeah. Well, I think he did very respectably. Mm-hmm. He has nothing to hang his head about at all.
Oh yeah, no.
It was a tough match. He did everything he could. If you don't know your five pointer. You don't even know your five pointer. Sometimes you get the 12th Mooney out. It is what it is. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I'll never forget the 12th Mooney out. Ever.
I posted a poll in the Facebook group today. I know, Andrew, you're not in there, so I won't tell you the results if you don't want to know them.
Mm-hmm.
After this match, I put who will now win the Star Wars tournament, and there's now obviously seven competitors left. Mm-hmm. Or yes, so do you want to know the results, or would you rather not?
Probably not.
Probably
if
not.
I had to guess.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
So it's but it's up there if anybody wants to vote on it. It's in the Facebook group right now.
Yeah, I told Andrew, I'm like, as your local manager, when Tom Dagnino's not here, I advise you to not look.
Oh, you
anywhere.
Smart. you would not. You wouldn't know how many times like something would be posted on Facebook or and like at this point I'm not even doing that anymore. And I would be like, I would immediately like, what? And immediately want to yell out to everybody. She's like,
no point.
Stop that. Don't do that.
No point.
Yeah.
So,
it is. I always think it's actually beneficial when the competitor, especially if they're active during the season, that they stay out because it's
for sure.
The fans are going to act like sports fans. That's what we're asking them to
exactly.
do. And it's like it's hard not to take it personal, but like they're rooting for who they like, and they're going to express what they think. And I think you've gotten a lot of love, but it's like, it's one of those things where, and you're now on that Finstock exchange, and now the Finstock exchange, they're becoming the Yankees. They're becoming,
the
BK Patriots, and everybody now wants them to lose.
Yeah.
And it just happens. It's the nature of the beast. Mm-hmm. It's just how it goes. Of course, the Finstock exchange fans are going to fight with you guys to the depths of hell. But it's everybody else that wants you to go down. You know, that's just how it goes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So obviously this coming Wednesday, or as of, because this will air on Monday, this Wednesday is the match between myself and Scrimshaw. We're not going to talk so much about this because, you know,
I wonder who we're going to pick.
but I just, again, since you're on, we have a third person. What are your thoughts? I'm not going to ask you who you're going to pick, yeah. but what do you see? How do you see this shaking out?
I see a scrap. I see the writers having to do what we did for Lord of the Rings and have extra questions for sudden death ready to go, because this is going to be either a 15-20 round sudden death match, or it's going to be one of these things like, oh my god, how did I miss that? I slipped on the word. I forgot this. You've gone through that before with your odds question.
Yeah.
You know, like that's like it's old wounds, but it's one of those things. That's what it's going to be, because Scrimshaw knows it. Scrimshaw is a guy where, you know, he's a scary competitor because he's just plugged in and he knows all this information, and he's just really smooth and he's cool and he's funny and he's like, he doesn't you don't ever see him really get worked up, and you're not going to see him argue or scream and yell when he's challenging, or it's just not in his nature to do. That's why he's the Jedi, right?
Yep.
And so I see it, and I don't know you well enough yet too, but what I've seen is that you're determined, you know, and I see that you want this and you talk about this, and you seem to be one of those players that under pressure, you know, it's like you welcome it. But there is a lot of pressure on you, and for a lot of different reasons. And I've said it. There's pressure, is that it's going to be very hard to get a match at 0-3, right? It's going to be. It's also Finn Stock Exchange right now are in first place. You win this match, then they're going to be in really good shape. You lose it, it opens up the gates. I mean, that's there's a lot of pressure there, but that's also part of being part of the Finn Stock Exchange.
Yeah.
But the flip side of that is the glory in it, that if you win and you get those 3 points, and hell, if you do the unthinkable and do the TKO to Scrimshaw and you get 4, then you're going to be the hero of the Finstock Exchange. Yeah. You know, so it's like, this is why we play the game, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And exactly. I will say the pressure is there. We've had the discussion. It was like, hey, we need you to perform. We need these points, because if you lose, then, you know, we have to make up in the IG and the singles. Bring it on. That's all I'll say. Scrimshaw better be prepared, because again, I have not. This has been on my mind since my loss, and this is all I'm searching. I don't want to give away my promo, but I've never been so determined to perform, and I've never wanted anything more than I do my shot at Alex. So that's all I'll say.
Have you ever spoken to Scrimshaw?
Yeah, I spoke to him before the Chicago match. Spoken to him after his title shot against Alex. He's a super cool guy, but not looking at him that way this next week.
Yeah, no, I get it.
He is the enemy.
You gotta look at him. He's in your way.
Yep. Yeah. He's in the
way. Do you have a preference of who you'd play next? That's something I'm waiting to see if my wife has not ordered the food yet, so I'll stick around until if that's cool with you guys.
Oh,
sure.
So the question that I had for you is that this is. You have made it very clear that you want Alex Damon. Alex Damon is on. He's in Rocky IV. He's the Drago in the mirror.
Yeah.
Like 100%. But in the next bracket over, or right above you, is his wife. So if Molly, who also wants to make a name for herself, if she winds up taking out Adam Witt, which is certainly possible, and you find yourself squaring off against Molly, is that kind of like first strike against Alex?
Absolutely. I mean, if I have to take down a Damon to get to Damon, to another Damon, so be it. I mean, that's the thing. And I'm not... if I go up against Witt, it's unfamiliar territory, because obviously I haven't gone up against him, but I've gone against Molly before. And, you know, I performed against her, and I've done well against her, so...
Right.
But who knows? She might have brushed up all... I said it before that her performance in Chicago is more... You know,
it's. I don't really think it's.
I don't think it's indicative. It's a lot like me. It's not an indicative of her knowledge. It's not. It's a lot
no,
of.
No, I
just,
think the live. Yeah.
A lot of gameplay stuff. So.
Well, it's a live event. I think got to her. Also, I think that she's gonna be more comfortable from her home. But there's something though that I'm like, oh man, I wish this tournament. I wish we could do it live, because imagine, you guys, and it's the Dimalantas versus the Scrimshaws. I mean, excuse me, versus the Damons. Mm-hmm. It's like, to me, that's like. That would be awesome. What a story that would be.
That would be hilarious.
It would be hilarious. But anyway.
That would be fun. And people have asked about that before, like, oh, what about the demons?
I'm sure.
Demons.
I mean, who knows? Maybe we'll do a tag Star Wars match somewhere down the line.
It could be a fun exhibition. Who knows?
Who knows? But so I think we're going to go ahead and wrap that up because I don't want to keep you longer than and you have to be because you got
a busy man.
Busy man.
Busy boy.
Right. Stuff to do. Right. But we usually hear at the end of the shows, we have like, hey, guess where can we find you online? And
where can they find you?
Christian online?
Can you provide them a link on Twitch so that they don't have to hunt for it, Christian?
probably. I couldn't believe that. So I couldn't believe it. I haven't seen that guy in the Facebook group since. But it's like unbelievable. I refuse to watch it. It's like, don't watch it.
Hey, Christian, try to survive without my views.
How does a guy watch television? I refuse to change the channel to go to channel 7.
I want all my content on one channel.
Talking about. Oh, I'm an idiot.
Amazing.
But yeah, so if you haven't followed the Schmoedown at all, I don't even know why you're listening to the show and you're not following the Schmoedown.
Probably wouldn't be.
SCN Live, obviously, every morning.
Yeah.
Go ahead and fill in everything else that I'm forgetting.
The main thing right now is just to remind everybody, I guess, that on this Monday, if you're a patron on the Movie Trivia Schmoedown, if you go to patreon.com/schmoedown, you can get the Ben Goddard and Vavida match, the play-in match. You can get it early. You want to do it because, you know, you want to start to check out those brackets and fill out your own brackets and see how you're going to do and how will he do and how will Vavida be, you know? So that's going to be a really good match. And then on Friday, you got Greg Alba and the Warfather. So
nice. That's okay. Awesome.
It's like we're back.
Because we've never seen Vavida in Inner Geekdom, right?
No, David has never. No, nice. He's never played in any singles match. He's only played in teams.
And same with Alba.
Same with Alba. That's right. Yes. So Alba, I mean, Alba's played in free for alls before, but he's never played in anything but teams. Mm-hmm. So who knows how the real rejects are going to be? You know, it just didn't seem, besides Mara Kanopic, that Koi has anybody on his squad that can play IG. So I think, you know, he just has to go down the line and pick some people. But who knows? Maybe they surprise people. You never know.
Yeah, who knows?
And then, you know, on that side, Goddard looking to be a triple threat.
Goddard's got a really good push for Rookie of the Year.
He can. I think it all is dependent on how he does in this. And then all the spotlight's going to be on him with the singles tournament. It's like, that's how he's going to lock it up. If he can, even if he doesn't get himself a title shot, if he advances, if he can get himself two or three rounds into the singles, and if he can win one or two matches, one match in Inner Geekdom and another match in teams, I think he's got it locked.
Oh yeah. I can't wait. This is a
Barbarian. That's what I wanted to do for you guys. Before there's a Barbarian. So I have not done this yet. I haven't even shown this. I have the Barbarian's theme song. I haven't put it on SEN. I haven't put it on anywhere, and it's going to debut. We're taping his match soon, and we're going to debut it. I was going to debut it on that match, but I will debut it on this show.
Exclusive to Beyond the Schmoedown.
If I can find it, I got it. Okay, it's really good. All right, this is the demo. What's the final one?
David B.
Yeah, let me bring it up. So let's and then we'll call it a day here. But I wanted to, I had brought it up and now it's gone. But give me a second. I have to play it though.
Yeah, I'll plug a couple of things. So Nicki Dimalanta, where can you find it?
Twitter DIMMMYYY. That's me.
That's the quickest you've ever done that. Yeah. As for me, you can follow me on Twitter and Twitch at Drew Dimalanta DIMALANT. I know I haven't been streaming as much, obviously, because I'm preparing. If you listen to us on audio form, please rate, follow us on podcast feed, Beyond the Schmoedown podcast feed. Like, subscribe, to like this video, comment below, subscribe to the channel. And if you have not, if you feel so inclined, join the Patreon, patreon.com/AndrewandNikki. Become a member of the squadron. Thank you to all of our Patreon supporters, especially our squadron commanders, Tamar Bada and Alec Miller.
Yeah.
All right, I found it. This is the Barbarian's theme. The Barbarian has heard it. I sent it to him.
Oh, nice.
But no one has heard this yet. It's maybe my favorite theme so far. All right, here it is.
Oh, we don't hear anything.
You know, I can't hear anything.
Oh no, I don't hear anything.
Oh, no. maybe it was that thing that we did beforehand.
No, I don't think it is. It should be able to play on yours.
Really, you guys can't hear me through that. Let me try to do. Let me see if that even at the echo. Let me see it. Hold on. Let me try that, and see if it works.
All right, we'll mute ourselves so that.
Yeah.
Patty boy, it's me. Daddy's having trouble.
All right, you heard that? Okay, good. So then you should be able to hear this then. Okay, here we go. Hear it now? Here we go. It's gone? What happened? Let's try it again. Here we go. Right through. All right, I got it. Hold on. Here we go. Sorry. How great is that?
That's awesome.
That's awesome.
It's so good. There you go. You're better now. It's better okay. now. So, it was he had put that together. It's like and I could just picture that. I want so badly to put the Barbarian in a live arena match to have him heading at these walking down.
That's awesome.
That's awesome.
All right.
Yeah.
Cool. Let's go get this food now.
Yeah. So
all right, guys.
Yeah. Thank you so much for joining us, Kristian.
Thank you.
And just really quick, I never got to ask you to thank you for this amazing opportunity to bring me into the Schmoedown. And because without the Schmoedown, this show doesn't exist. And without me and the Schmoedown, this show probably doesn't get much traction.
Thank you for the Schmoedown.
Yes. Thank you for the Schmoedown overall.
You guys have been great. You're really very supportive. And your show's really fun to listen to. And, every take. Still a take.
With that, we will end the show there.
What? We can't end like that.
Should be a soundbite.
Thank you so much for joining us on this episode of Beyond the Schmoedown. We will see you guys
next time.